Ravinder?
Yes.
Yeah, you can start now. Yeah, now you can. Go ahead.
So please note that first of all, we'll be disabling the chat and muting everyone so as to avoid any interference in the between. So only the speaker's mic and audio and video will be on, so there's no disturbance. You can wait for the Q&A session for your doubts and queries. You can put forth your questions in the Q&A session itself by using the option raising your hand. Okay, so sir, shall I proceed with the introduction? Okay. Moving forward, on the behalf of whole FICARSD team, I, Arshia Mahajan, would now like to extend a warm welcome to our second speaker for the day, Dr. Subhanil Chaudhary, who is an assistant professor at Institute of Development Studies, Kolkata. He has worked on globalization, labor, and macroeconomics. Dr.
Please
Chaudhary's.
Share
Yes,
your
Shubhi.
target.
Oh, sorry, sir. Shubhi, can you
Yeah,
share the screen? Right. Dr. Chaudhary's articles have been published in Indian Journal of Labour Economics, Economic and Political Weekly, and many other journals. Also, he's written a book entitled Limits of Bargaining, Capital, Labour, and State in Contemporary India, which is published by the Cambridge University Press. Dr. Subhanil Chaudhary regularly contributes in magazines and newspapers like The Frontline, The Hindu, and the Ananda Bazaar, which is in Bangla. He's also the chief editor of a reputed Bengali magazine called Arek Rakam. We are looking forward to learn a lot from this session, sir. It's great having you here with us today.
Thank
So,
you. So should I begin?
sir,
Okay.
please.
Thank you for the very kind introduction, and thanks to the Economics Department of ARSD College, and particularly to Dr. Naidu for giving me this opportunity. I was a student at Jawaharlal Nehru University many years back, and I was a regular visitor near your college because of many other reasons, which this is not a place to discuss those. So I have very good memories about ARSD College and on some of my seniors teach there. Ranjan Swarnakar is one of my very beloved seniors from Jawaharlal Nehru University. So it's good to be here. So without much ado, let me go into the topic of today's discussion, which is with regard to R. And I know that the earlier discussion was on strata. So let me just say a few words about R before beginning my formal presentation. Now, R is a freely available statistical software which was designed by certain computer programmers who were interested in works on statistical issues like regression and other analysis. It is freely available, freely downloadable, and it has a great amount of flexibility, which makes it one of the leading softwares to use in your econometric analysis. Now, I hope I had sent an email earlier to Dr. Naidu. I hope you have downloaded R and RStudio in your computer. If you have not, you have
Yes,
to
sir.
do it fast. So I presume that all of you have RStudio installed in your computer. So without much ado, let us just begin whatever I have to discuss today. So you see, the first thing that you should understand is that while R is the software, RStudio is basically an IDE, which is an integrated development environment where you can write codes to ease your working with R. But R is the basic software which is running the show. RStudio is the kind of stage where you are writing your codes and all that. So let me first begin with R. There should be an R icon in your desktop or somewhere. If you open that R icon, you open that, something like this will come. So this is the basic art without the art studio. And if you write, let us say, if you just type 5 + 4 here, you see the answer is 9. So the basic property, I mean, R can function as a calculator. The least that R can do is that it can perform, it can do the job of a calculator. You write 5 by 4, 1.25, 5 times 4, 20, whatever. Any calculative operation that you want to do, you can do it here. For example, if you want to know the log of, let us say, 10, and we are now coming into the various functions of R. One of the simplest functions is to find the log value of any number. So you type log 10, it comes 2.30. Why? Because the base, if you just write log, then the base R takes it as E. And if you write log 10, 10, what should be the value? 1. So basically this says that the first value is the number that you want to put into the function, and the second value is the base on which you want to run the logarithmic value. So this is your basic R. You can do, these are trivial things. I don't want to go on and on about it. But what is obvious is, suppose you want to run 2-3 lines together. Suppose you want to run whatever, 2-3 lines together, it will not come. The moment you press enter, R will start executing the line and it will come to the next line. Because of this, generally people do not work on R. What they work on is Art Studio. So without wasting any time, we now directly go to Art Studio. Open your Art Studio. So this is your Art Studio. There are many codes written because I was working on something. But let us begin afresh. Now, what is this Art Studio? As I said, that Art Studio is an IDE. It is an integrated development environment. You can write various kinds of software codes in Art Studio, not only R, but others also. But here we will be sticking to R. Now, as you can see, that there are four windows. There are four windows in your Art Studio environment. This is one window. This is the second window. This is the third window. And this is the fourth window. Now, what are these windows? This is the window where we write our codes. For example, you see, I have written some codes here. And we will go through this, don't worry. And this is the place where we write our codes. And it makes it easy to run every code one line by one line. Suppose I run 5 + 4. How do I run? There is a run key here, run button. You press it and the output will come in the window below this. This space is called console, R console. It is already written here. It is called the R console. So if you execute any code here, log 10, you execute any code here, the output will come here. Suppose you are saying log A. Suppose this is just to, we have not defined what A is. Suppose we are saying log A. You see error, A not found. So whatever you execute, whether it is error or the correct output, it will be shown in the console. You can also directly, for some very small calculations like we were doing in the R mother program, we can do it here also, 5 × 4, 20. So this is the place where you write your code, and this is the place where the output is shown. And this is the space where you will be showing, the data will be shown. Whatever data you load, the name of the data, the name of the important variables, I will come to it once we start loading the data. So this is the space where these things will be visible. And this is the space where you have the plots, whatever plot you draw, the histogram, box plot, scatter plot, whatever plot you want to draw, the output of that plot will be shown here. I will show you obviously how to draw the various kinds of graphs. And this is the files on your computer where you are storing whatever you want to store. This is the plot, these are the packages. Now, packages are very important, and let me spend a minute or two on packages. You see, the the system that we have loaded right now is what is called base R. That is, the basic functionality of R has been loaded. But for your own requirement, as you need more and more sophisticated functions other than log or addition or subtraction, you need statistical packages, for example, running logistical regressions. You need packages for running, if you want to do machine learning, for example, then you would be needing various kinds of packages. So what the architects of R have done is that they have kept the basic R very simple. And if you need more sophisticated options, then those are stored in separate packages called libraries. And here you have the libraries that have been installed in my computer. These are the libraries which we have. I have installed in my computer. I will show you some of them. And this is the help. You need help. How to get the help, I will also show. Okay, so let us first, in order for particularly for this session, let us first load some libraries into R. And this hash symbol is important. If you run this hash symbol, can you please don't make me the host, because people are coming in and I am continuously getting
yes, of course. So
somebody has joined and not joined. Yeah.
So
if you, anything that follows a hash, let me just show you. Suppose you say log, after hash, you say log 10, and you run this. Nothing happens. So whenever there is a hash symbol, R understands that that line is not to be run. So if you run all these hashes and load library, nothing will come. Why is this important? This is important because if you are running large blocks of codes, if you are writing large blocks of codes, sometimes we tend to forget what we are actually doing with the codes. Let me show you one example. Here, you see every step it is written, download the data file from World Bank website, upload the data from the working directory. Following is the main data file. So when you come back to your codes later, you will be able to understand what was being done. Otherwise, because there are complicated codes, as you can see here, you will not be able to understand what was happening. Secondly, if you want to share this with somebody, then also it is very a good practice. It is not a necessary practice, but it is a good practice that you write. Suppose I want to, so as I said, load library. And I say that load the tidyverse library. So when you are running the program, you will know, when you are looking at the codes, you will know that what it is that you are being asked to do, what is it that you are asking rather R to do. Now, I had told Dr. Naidu that you need to install the tidyverse package for this session. I will be asking you to install many, many more packages, but one of the basic packages that needs to be installed is tidyverse. Okay. And let me also tell you, obviously all of you are on in net connection, otherwise this session was not possible. But it is always good practice to do R with a net connection on, such that you stop anywhere, you can Google the question, whatever you problem you are facing. Or you need to bring in some packages, you need to bring in some data, whatever that is. So if for those who have not stored the R tidyverse package, you need to write this install.packages. And this is another function, this is another fun of RStudio, that the moment you start typing, it will prompt you to various commands. For here, we need the install packages command. And within install package, you write tidyverse and press enter. Or you can do it here also, but here it is not, because you would be saving this. And then every time there is no point in loading this. So just type install.packages within bracket, within quotes, tidyverse. Just somebody tell me that you have done it, then I will move to the next.
I will share that link, sir, with all the participants so that they can.
Yeah. So you should know, but for this session itself, you need to install it. Otherwise, people will not be able to understand.
Yes. I think most of the students, they already installed because last time we are having that.
Okay. So, yeah. So once you have installed this, okay, I am assuming that all of you are new to R. So that is why I am starting from the absolute zero. Now you just run library tidyverse and you just run it. The moment you run it, these are the packages that have been loaded. Tidyverse is a collection of packages and these are the packages, ggplot2, tbuild, tidyr, whatever, par, dplyr, and all these things. Okay, so this is one step. Tidyverse is a very good package. It allows us much flexibility, particularly the graphics of Tidyverse.
After installing it, what we are supposed to do?
After you have installed, you go to this place, this R script, write library within brackets Tidyverse, and you then run this line by pressing this run icon, run button. Type library Tidyverse and run. You can also do it here, but I'm doing it here because if you want to save this code, then you have to write it here. Whatever you say write here will not be saved. And then when you run this, this thing should come. Attaching packages. These are the packages that Tidyverse is a collection of packages. It is not only one package. It is a collection of these many packages. 8 packages are there. Okay. Okay, we'll come back to Tidyverse in just a minute. But before that, we need to do with some things. One is that this is the basic. You can actually save this. You just press Control Save. This will come and you save it whatever you want to save it. Whatever you save in this format, it is called an R script. R script is the basic, absolutely basic level R codes. You save the codes in a file called rscripts and it has an extension .r. And then the second thing, this is number one point that I was trying to make, that you can use R as a calculator. And if you want R to do better things, it is good that you install packages like Tidyverse. That is one point that I have made. The second point is about R objects. What are R objects? R objects are of many kinds. The basic R object is a variable. Suppose I say that X is equal to 5. And you run this. X equal to 5, you run it. You see there is this value has come, x, 5. X is a variable, 5 is the value. Or you can also generally R, in some of the versions, R does not take the equality sign. It needs to do is, you take the less than sign and then the hyphen, and you say, let us say 4. And you run this. Again, you see there is y, 4. So X and Y are R objects. And you can then do various kinds of things with X and Y. You can write X plus Y. And you see 9 is the answer. You can say you want to know 2 times X plus Y. What is the answer? Here is the answer, 14. Or you want to just save Z. You want another thing called Z. Z is equal to this less than and hash sign is equal to in R parlance. You just want to say Z is equal to X square plus Y square or the equation of A. Just a quadratic kind of equation. And you run it. So you have stored Z. And you want to know the value of Z, just type Z here. You got 48. So these are R objects, very simple R objects. We will obviously make it more and more complex as we proceed. Now, there are also string objects in R. Suppose there is, you want to save A is equal to, what is string? Strings are alphanumeric, as you must be knowing from various other sources, that strings are basically alphanumeric variables, alphanumeric characters. So I can write A as hello world. You run it. So A becomes hello world. And you must be very careful when you are assigning an R object to a string. All strings must come within the quotation marks, be it single or double, doesn't matter, but it must come within quotation marks. Now, once we have the strings, what we can do is, we can substring, we can do a substring of the strings. That means you want to bring out specific characters from the strings. Suppose you don't know how to do it. Suppose I don't know how to do it. Then what do I do? I need to go to R's help. And how do I go to R's help? You just type question mark and you type substring. This is substring. And paste enter. Here it will come. Substring X start stop. That means X is the string that you want to substring from. Start is the start position. Stop is the stop position. Suppose I want to substring the first five values from X. In our case, it is A, 1, 5. A, 1, 5. You run this. You see, hello has just been cut off from here. So substring A start position, end position. Then you will be able to extract the substring. Suppose I want to substring due to whatever reason. I mean, we should not find right now. Suppose I want to substring my name. The first five letters of my name. You see, the first five letters has come. Suppose maybe in some codes you just need the the first letter of any name. Then you just write 1, 1. Yes. So substring is a very nice function, and you can have substring of various combinations, and you can find the help here. Okay, so now we have learned that there are, okay, now suppose right now what I have said till now, I have already said that X equal to 5, Y equal to 4, and therefore you know that X and Y are numerical vectors, numerical numbers, and you know that A is a string. But suppose you don't know that. Suppose you have been given with a very large data, and you don't know which is the kind of data that you have, which is the kind of thing that you have. For that, you have many commands. One of them is type of. Just type of X. So it will say what is actually X. It's a double. Double is basically a number. I'm sure that in Stata, it has been explained that what double is. Double is basically a floating number that R takes. Then suppose you say type of A, and then it will show you character. A is a character or string. Or you can say class of X is numeric, and class of A is character. So you can easily, and we will show that in while working with large data sets, you need to know what your variables stand for, whether they are numeric, whether they are alphanumeric, and so on. Okay, now let us complicate our lives by bringing in vectors. R as a vectorized language. R works in terms of vectors. If you have to remember one thing about R, the most important thing to be remembered about R is that R is a vectorized language. If you can understand that, you have, what should I say, you have started your journey in R in a very good way. And if you have not understood it, then you will not be able to understand how R operates. So R is a vectorized language. You can write it on your wall if you are really serious about R. And I must say before, I should have said it right in the beginning, that R is a fairly complicated language. And because it is a language, nobody can say that I know everything that is to be known about R. Because nobody can say that I know everything that is to be known about English. You can change the, every day you know more words. Every day you change the usage. Similar is the case with R or any other computer language. Obviously, they will follow a syntax like English, Bangla, Hindi. All the languages have a syntax, but they can be used in infinite number of possible ways. Similar is the case with R. So R is a vectorized language. This is one of the most important thing that you remember about R. Now, what is a vector? A vector is a collection of, you know from your mathematics course that your vector is a collection of numbers. Now, how do I know, how do I make vectors in R? We make vectors in R by the C command. C and then you say a bracket. And you want to place any number that you want to place. Suppose you want 10, 11, 18, 25, 27, 33. Six numbers are there. X is therefore what we call a numeric vector, and you run it and you see X is changed. It's a number 1 to 6, six elements are there, 10, 11, 18, 15. Additionally, unlike mathematics, you can have a vector in R which is a numeric vector. Alphanumeric vector, string vector, A and B are strings. You run it. Can you please stop my, I don't want to be the host. Every time students are coming in and my screen is getting blocked. A and B are strings. So you run it. And you will find that Y is now a character vector. It is already written, CHR, having five elements, 1:5, A and B are strings. And if you just run Y, it will come up with this thing. And if you run X, it will show you the numbers that is stored in X. Okay. So R reads everything as vectors. Everything R reads as vectors. Even when you have a single element, it is actually a vector for R. And R operates in terms of vectors. Okay, now before that, suppose you have a huge vector, you have a very large vector. And in the days of big data, the length of the vectors can be of very, very large size. Suppose you want to know the number of elements that are present in the vector, which you don't know from before, because obviously these are all constructed vectors. I have constructed them myself. So I know there are five elements and six elements in this case. But suppose you don't know that and you want to find it out. For that, there is a function in R called length, L-E-N-G-T-H, length. Length X. That basically gives you the length of the vector. In other words, what are the how many numbers are there in the vector? And you run it. Please stop me from being the host. I am not being able to concentrate because every second somebody is coming and it's blocking my screen.
Yes, sir, I'll speak to Naidu sir about this. Just a second.
Okay, so length X. So you run this. You see six. Within length, how many elements are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If you run length X, it is giving 6. You run length Y, what should it give? should give you 5. So length x 6, length y 5. Length therefore gives you the number of elements in the vector. Suppose you want to find out the summation of this vector. Obviously for strings that is not possible. You cannot sum up a and b because they are not numeric numbers. But suppose you want to know the sum of the elements of these vectors. In many cases you need that. Suppose this is the income of your family members in, let us say, 100 rupees. So 1000, 1100, whatever. And you know that you want to know the total family income. So you need to add up these numbers. How do you add up? Very simple, sum of x, right? Sum of x, 124. And in this way, you can find out various other important characteristics of the number. One very important command that is one of the most often used command, widely used command, is the summary command. Summary. Let us say what happens if I say summary of y, that is the string vector. It just says that it is length 5, it's a character, and its mode of entry is also a character. So no numbers are generated other than the length. Why? Because y itself is a string vector. So there is no possibility of generating numbers from string vectors other than the length. And now suppose you write summary x and you run it. You see, it's a very important command. It gives you the minimum value in the vector 10, the first quantile 12.75, the median, the mean, the third quantile, and the maximum value of the vector. So it is what is called a 5-number summary. Minimum, first one, Q1, median, Q3, maximum. In addition to this, this is also giving you the mean. In strata, for example, you will have this in the describe command. If you say, describe. If you just say describe the data, it will describe the data and give you the summary statistics. But here we have summary of X and it gives you, and it is a very important thing when we will be discussing the ordinary least square methods. You will understand that how flexible this summary function actually is. Okay, now suppose you want to sort the data. Suppose you want to sort the data. You want to arrange the variables. Let us say we just write sort. Sort is the command. Sort x. What happens? It arranges the vector from the minimum to the maximum. But suppose you don't want to arrange from the minimum to the maximum. Rather, you want to arrange from the maximum to the minimum. Then what you do? You say sort x, comma, decreasing. You see, it is giving me the prompt already. Decreasing equal to true. So Boolean values, true, false, are also a kind of important parameters, important characteristics of R. For that matter, any computer language, which I'll just discuss. But let us say sort x decreasing equal to 2. What does it give? You see, it has arranged it in the descending order. 33, 27, 25, 18. Now, because we are into this logical operators, true and false, suppose we just say 4 equal to 5. And we run it. Invalid operation, left hand side to assign. Okay, let us say, okay. Now, if you want to test whether 4 is equal to 5, I mean, it's a trivial thing, but to make you understand the functionalities, I'm just giving you an example. So 4 equal to I, 5 give me an error. But if you want to test actually whether something is equal to something, you give 2 equal to signs, 4 equal to 5, and you run. False. 4 is not equal to 5. Let us say 4 less than 5. Run it. True. 4 is less than 5. 4 greater than 5. Run it. False. 4 is obviously not greater than 5. Now, because these are numbers, it is obvious. I mean, you might be thinking that why am I being told in this beautiful afternoon whether 4 is equal to 5 or not? because the purpose is not whether 4 is equal to 5. The purpose is to understand how these operators operate. Because later on, we will be needing this in order to subset our data. Suppose you want, I have shared with you an HDR data. Suppose you want to know that what are the countries which are greater than 50, greater than 0.5 HDI value. Then you need to know how to subset. And for that, you need these logical operators, greater than equal to, less than, and less than equal to. And there is another logical operator, which is not. Not, let us say, we say not. Not is given by an exclamation mark. Not 4 less than 5. What is 4 less than 5? 4 less than 5 gave us true. So what should not 4 less than 5 give us? False. Not is the negation of truth. So if it is true, it will be false. If it is false, it will be true. So these are the logical operators. And then, okay, so we have discussed vectors, how to get the sum, how to get the length of the vectors, how to get the summary statistics of the vectors. Now we'll have to do some vector operations. I mean, dealing with one vector is not the purpose. You will be dealing with thousands of vectors when you finally do data operations. So we need to understand how R deals with vectors. Suppose I have a vector. Any vector has to be started with C. C means combine. A vector like this, 10, 9, 11, 90, 78, 89, and these commas are very important, huh? 34. Suppose this is one vector, I run it. And then I have another vector B, C, 11, 92, 34, 67, 6, 99, 1. We have another vector B and we run it. Now suppose, what should be A plus B? Now in vector algebra, A plus B is, as you know, the geometric in the two-dimensional space, this is the diagonal of the parallelogram, and in multidimensional space, you need to do some more calculations. But in R, what it will do is it will add up element by element. So if you are doing A plus B, then the element in the new vector A plus B would be 10 plus 11, 21, 9 plus 92, 101, 11 plus 34, 45, and so on. Let us see whether that happens or not. So you run A plus B. You see 21, 101, 45, 157, 84, 34 plus 1, 35. So what it does is, when you are giving two vectors to R and you are asking for a mathematical operation between those two vectors, what R does is, it goes element by element. The first element will be added to the first element, the second element to the second element, and so on. If it is multiplication, same thing. First element to be multiplied by the first element, second element to be multiplied by the second element, and so on. You see, 10 into 11, 110, 9 into 92, 828, 34 into 1. 34. So the important takeaway point is, and again, A by B, whatever you do, it will go element by element. Whatever you do. So the important takeaway point is that vector operations in R are done element by element. So if you want to add two vectors, it will add the first element to the first element, second element to the second element, and so on. Division, subtraction, multiplication, logarithmic, whatever you want to do, it will give you the, it will do it element by element. But obviously, there is a problem. And what is the problem? In this case, at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, there are 7 elements in both the vectors. Now the question is, what happens if both the vectors do not have the same length or do not contain the same number of elements? Because here we are going element by element. So what happens if the number of elements are not equal? Let us see. suppose I reassign A as 1, 1, 2, 3, 4. Let us say this is my A now. And B equals C, 1, 2. Okay. Now, let us see what happens A plus B. Earlier, what was happening? That element by element, 1 plus 1, 2, 2 plus 2, 4. But now my second and third, after the second element in the second vector, there are no third and fourth elements. So what will R do? That is the question we are trying to understand. What R will do is, it will add up the first element to the first element, the second element to the second element, and then it will again repeat the smaller vector. So here 3 plus 1, 4, 4 plus 2, 6. So as per my estimate, the value of A plus B should be 1 plus 1, 2, 2, 4, 4, and 6. Because 1 plus 1, 2, 2 plus 2, 4, then 3 plus 1, 4, 4 plus 2, 6. So you run this A plus B, you see 2, 4, 4, 6. So what it does is, if there is a smaller vector, it adds up the smaller vector to the maximum possible elements. Here there are two elements which it can add up to. And then it adds again the smaller vector to the remaining elements. It is that the vector, the smaller vector kind of crawls on the larger vector repeatedly till the time that the larger vector gets exhausted. The elements in the larger vector gets exhausted. Why is this important? This is important because when you have a large data, you must understand what is being added and what is being multiplied. Otherwise, you will fall into errors. So it is always good practice to check whether the elements, number of elements, or the length of the two vectors are same, and then perform the operations. But again, you have a problem. And the problem is that in this case, the larger vector was a multiple of the smaller vector. I mean, the length of the larger vector was a multiple of the length of the smaller vector. Why? Because A has four elements and B had two elements. So 2 into 2, multiple of 2. But suppose we have a vector again, A, let us say C, 1, 9, 3, 1. Suppose there are 4 elements, but B has, let us say, 2 elements, 1 and 2. Sorry, not 1 and 2. Let us just add another element here. So there are 5 elements in A and B has 2 elements, or maybe let us say 3 elements. 1, 2, 3. So what is happening earlier? Element by element is adding up. If it is a multiple, then the vector is kind of crawling on the larger vector. So again, the two are added up. But here, the larger vector is not a multiple of the smaller vector. Then what is happening? So we run A, you run B, and then you run A plus B. So what will happen is 1 plus 1, 2, 9 plus 2, 11, 3 plus 3, 6. So 2, 11, 6. Again, the 1, 2, 3 vector will again fall below 1 and 5. So 2, 7, and the 3 will be left out. So the total value would be 2, 11, 6, 2, 7. There will be 5 elements, 2, 11, 6, 2, 7. Let us see. 2, 11, 6, 2, 7. And it is giving you a warning. The longer object length is not a multiple of shorter object. Warnings doesn't matter. It does not mean an error has occurred. What it R is telling you that you should be mindful of the fact that the larger vector is not a multiple of the smaller. The length of the larger vector is not a multiple of the smaller. Okay, so you have understood. Any questions till now? Otherwise, I'll move to the next topic.
Yes, if anyone has any question, you can raise your hand using the raise hand option. So, sir will take up your questions. Anyone?
Chat box enable, dear participant, please, if you have any query, text your queries, or you can ask direct to the speaker.
Okay, I think till now it was pretty elementary. So let me then get on with it.
Yes, sir. Please proceed. I think there's no doubt, queries.
Okay, now we have understood the basics of. I have kept the examples deliberately very simple. Don't get bored by it. It is very easy to get bored. But in just a few minutes, you will understand the importance of understanding these very simple things, without which you will not never be able to understand how R operates. Now we are coming into the real meat, that is naming the elements of a vector. Suppose we have this vector. We have this vector x. Let us name the vector. We have already, this is my x vector, 10, 11, 18, 25, 27, 30. Now you want to name the each element of this vector. Suppose this is the mathematics score of 6 students, 10, 11, 18, 25, 27, 33. And you want to assign the names of the students to every element, such that later on you are not confused. How do you do it? You do that by the function names. Names x is equal to c. How many elements are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So there should be 6 names. So let us just say a, b, c, B, E, and F, and you run it. Now you again run X. You see, earlier X was just the numbers. Now after you run X, every element of X has been named. A, 10, B, 11, C, 18, D, 25, E, so on and so forth. So why is naming important? Naming is important, not very important in the case of vectors, but in case of data, we will see that it is very important. But here also, if you have the names, the moment you call the vector, again you call the vector, you will have the names. So suppose you have stored the names of the students, names of the marks of the students in a vector without storing the names, then later on you might get confused. But if you have stored the names too, then there is no way you can forget, because the vector will give you the names. Now suppose, now we are coming to slicing a vector. Suppose you want to just look at the third element of the vector. Suppose, due to whatever reason, how do you do that? You do that. By using the third brackets, the box brackets, some people call it the box brackets. Box brackets are very important in R. If you do Python, it will find that even in Python, they are very important. Slicing a vector through box brackets. What do? You just say x. What is the element that you want to get? 3. X within box, you write 3. Run it. You see the third element, C18, has been extracted. Suppose you want to extract the element from 2 to 4, not only one element, but you want to extract the elements 2 to 4. How do you do that? 2 colon 4. Done it. You see BCD. Second, third, fourth. Suppose you want to delete the sixth element. Suppose. Then you just write x minus 6. You run it. You see the sixth element is gone. Slicing we will come back to when we deal with matrix and data frames. But this is the basic slicing. Suppose you have the mathematics scores for 1,000 students, and you want to arrange in a descending order or ascending order, whatever you want to do it. I have already taught you how to arrange them in descending order or ascending order. And you want to know that what is the, how many marks did the 900 student got? So you just write x square bracket 900 and you will get the 900 students marks. That is the purpose. Now after slicing, we have to come to what is called matrix in R. Now matrix is very important, and it's matrix. We are now really going into how to deal with the various kinds of data. Let us name an object M1 as a matrix. Matrix is the command through which you can convert a vector into a matrix. And let us say we just write 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. So how many elements are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. You run it, M1. So M1 is a matrix. And there are 9 elements in the matrix, obviously. And you just type M1 here. Oh, sorry. Yeah. So you see, if you just write matrix, it is not enough. It has made a 9-into-1 matrix. But suppose you want a 3-into-3 matrix, then you have to specify the number of rows, n row equal to 3, and then run it. Then you have M1. You see, obviously, if the number of rows is 3, then the number of columns would be 3 because there are 9 elements. But if you want to be more cautious, you write number of columns. And then you run M1. Okay, now two things to note. One is that how is the matrix getting filled? So you have 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 is the vector, which is now being converted into a matrix. It is filled column-wise, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. So whenever you are asking R to convert a matrix, convert a large vector into a matrix, it is basically filling the matrix column-wise by default. Second, you have these numbers, 1, 1, 2, 3. What are these numbers? These are the row numbers. 1, first row, these are the elements. Second row, these are the elements. Third row, these are the elements. And these are the column numbers, 1, 2, 3. So R understands elements by row, comma, column. First, you have to specify the row number, then the column number. We'll come to that in just a minute. But suppose you don't want to fill the matrix row-wise. Suppose you want to fill this matrix column-wise. What do you do? You copy this. And you write by row equal to true. Even if you just write capital T, it will understand that you mean true. And you run this. And then you... Now you see this, it is filled by row, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. So two ways of filling a matrix. By default, it will fill column-wise. And if you are specifying by row equal to true, then it will fill row-wise. And if you have forgotten how to fill the matrix, just type question mark matrix, enter. And it will show you all that relevant information in this right-hand lower panel. Okay, now we have understood how to create a matrix. By the way, we can also create matrices of strings, but I'm not going into it because we are really not very bothered about strings. Now let us see some examples of I am copying this data from another file. So let me copy piece by piece such that it becomes easier for you to understand. So this is basically basketball data. seasons is a vector, 2012, 2013, 2014. Now look, these are numbers, 2012, 2013, 2014 are numbers, but because they are within quotes, they will be read as strings. So you run this, seasons, players. These are the seasons, 2012 season, 13 season, 14 season, and these are the very famous basketball players in the United States, NBA, those who follow NBA. I don't, but those who follow might be knowing them. Now you have another series of vectors, games. 78-6-35, Kobe Bryant G. G basically stands for games. Joe Johnson G and LeBron James G. These are the number of...
Letters are showing very small number, in a small size. So better to can improve the size of the letters. Maybe participants will be getting. Yeah. And you can change any color in display. Yeah, better, I think. Yeah, front size. Yes.
Is it okay?
Yeah. Color you can change it, sir, if you don't mind. You can change some other color. I think it is, no. Yeah, maybe. Yeah, it is good. Good. Now, sir, it's fine. Maybe parts.
Okay, so, yeah. So, this is my... So this is my another three vectors. These basically stand for the three players and the number of games that they have played in this order: 2012, 76, 2013, 6, 2014, 35. Now you can run all these together. You just copy them. I mean, select them together and run. All these have been created in the data. You can see here. Now, sorry. Now there is another piece of data that you need, that is minutes played. How many minutes that they have played in every match that they have, total number of minutes that they have played in every season. So this is the Kobe Bryant 2012, 2013, so on and so forth. So you run this. Now, so you have three sets of vectors. One is seasons and players, another is Kobe Bryant, this number of games that they have played and number of minutes that they have played, and you want to combine them into a matrix of which will show the number of games that they have played in each season. So you want to convert this into a matrix called games, and that will be basically the these vectors will be combined into the games matrix. And that should be done by rows, because the things are arranged in that way. You see 78, 6, 35, basically 2012, 2013, 2014. So each, the first row should be Kobe Bryant, the second row should be Joe John, the third row should be LeBron James, and so on. So for that, you have a command called rbind. So you say rbind Kobe Bryant G, comma, Joe Johnson G, because number of games, we are talking about games right now, and LeBron James G. Run it. You have got a games as a matrix. You run games here. You see, we have now constructed a matrix out of a set of vectors by the rbind command. And you can also do it cbind, that is column bind, but I have not shown it here. And then you can have another game called, another this thing called minutes played, another matrix. And that would be rbind Kobe Bryant MP, because minute played, Joe Johnson MP, and LeBron MP, minutes played. So you run it. You have got this minutes played. and you run the minutes plate, you have got another matrix. Now you want to name these by the seasons. You have to name these 1, 2, 3. This is not looking nice. So what do you want to do? You want to name these by the seasons. How do you do that? These are what? Columns. And therefore column names. So column names of games is a matrix, is seasons. Seasons already I have here. I have run it. Seasons is here. So I just say column names, assign the column names of games to seasons and run it. Then you run games. You see, it has come. Similarly, you want the column names of minutes played also as seasons, because that is your, then you run minutes played. You see that 12, 13, 14 has come. So you have now learned how to construct a matrix, how to change the column names. And if you want, you can also change the row names. So you can say row names of games is basically the players vector that you have. You do that and you run games. The row names. Earlier you had this GG and all these things. Now you have simply Cobrand, Joe Johnson and all that. And you can change the row names of minutes played again by the players. Which name to assign is depends on your, on the kind of data that you have. Here we are very clear that which names to assign from the kind of data that we have. So minutes played, again you run, you see. So now you want to know, suppose that how many minutes did these players play for each game in every season. In other words, what you want to know is, you want to know this color is pretty bad. Let me again change the color into something bright, because so you want to know the number of minutes played by each player in each season. This is what you want to know. How do you do that? Can anybody tell me how to do that? Matrix is a collection of numbers. So basically what you want to do is, you want to look at the minutes played divided by games. You run it, you will have the answer. This is the answer. So again, what it is being done is, it is going vector by vector. So you have a vector here in 2012. The three players have 3013, 2642 and 287377 number of minutes. And the number of games played is 78, 72, 76. So you just do 3013 divided by 78. 13 divided by 78. Run it. 38.6281. Look, 38.6281 is here. Similarly, you run 2642 by 72. 2642 divided by 72. What do you get? You get 36.69444. You see 36.69444 is here. So it is again basically doing element by element division. The first column is the of the two vectors two matrices are the two vectors for the first operation, second operation, third operation. And you have the minutes played by games matrix, which is giving you the entire set of data. But this is not looking nice, 38.62821, so many decimal places we don't require. What do? We just say round. And again run this. It has taken the nearest decimal numbers. Suppose you want to look up to one decimal level, comma one. You want to look at to two decimal level, comma two. You don't want any decimal level. Okay. Clear? So very simple. Nothing much to worry about. Now what you are going to do is, we are going to know how to slicing a, don't worry, I will send you this entire code sheet, I will send you such that you can understand it. Slicing a matrix, how do you slice a matrix? Suppose you want to know the number of games played by Joe Johnson in the year 2014. That means what? Joe Johnson is the second row. Number of games played is here. Where is number of games played? Okay, let us just see. Games, you run the games matrix. This is the number of games, and you want to know the number of games played by Joe Johnson in 2014. So Joe Johnson is in your second row, 14 is in your second column. So you have to write games. Again, back to our box brackets for slicing. So Joe Johnson is second row. So first comes row, comma, column three. Second row, third column, 8. You just want to know how Joe Johnson has played in the entire season. So 2, comma, nothing else. So the second row, all the columns will be taken. Let us see how. Second row, all columns have been taken. Suppose you want the names too. So you write games. Joe Johnson, comma, run it. Same thing is coming. Even if you give the name, the same thing is actually coming. Suppose you want to know how the players played in the year 2014. So 2014 is the third column, and you want the number of games played by each player in the year 2014. So you need all the rows. So comma, 2014 is third column. You run it, 35, 18, 16. You check. You see 35, 18, 16. O'Brien played 35 games, Joe Johnson 80 games, Lee Jebdon James 16. And you can do so for 2012. Whatever. So comma, nothing, comma, column gives you the values of all the elements in that column. Something, comma, nothing gives you the rows of all the columns. So if you want to extract the column only, comma, the column number. And if you want to extract the row only, the row number, comma, nothing. That is the main slicing technology here. And if you want to know the only the values of the first and the second column, then you write comma, number of rows, everything will be taken, and the first to second column. 2014 is over. So you can use various combinations and do that kind of an analysis. Okay, now we have understood, hopefully, that how to generate a vector, how to generate a matrix. Now we will know how to generate set of random numbers. Random numbers, as you know, are very important, particularly if you are doing sampling. And there are many commands in R on the basis of which, okay, before generation, a set of numbers and random numbers. Sometimes you need to generate a series of numbers. Suppose you want to generate, for that the command is sec. Sec is for sequence. Sequence, let us say 10 to 30. Let us see what happens. Sequence 10 to 30. Why is it? If you just write 10 to 10 colon 30, what it is doing is 10, from 10, it is taking up to 30. And why is it doing it this way? I have no clue, because it should not. Okay, now I have understood. 10, 30. Let us see what happens. 10, 30. And you run this. You see the same thing. So 10 colon 30 and sequence 10, 30 are the same thing. But in colon, you cannot change the gap. It will be always one. But here you can change the gap. Let us say comma 5. See what happens. 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. So it starts from 10, ends at 30 with 5 gap. And if you want to know more, question mark sec. Here it is given from 1 to 1 by 2 and from so on and so forth. You'll be able to understand. So you generate a sequence of numbers, either through the colon sign if you want a continuous series, or through the, now we can also generate like this, minus 5 to 5, minus 4, minus 3. But suppose you want to reverse the order. How do you revise the order? You want from 5 to minus 5, then do nothing, 5 colon minus 5 and run it. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Colon sign is important because when we are doing some kinds of operations, we need a random sequence of numbers to keep track of our operations. In such cases, we need this. And then random numbers. Random numbers can be generated by two functions, many functions, but let me just show you two. One is the runif function, runif. Runif basically means a random function from the uniform distribution. Now, as your statistics course will tell you, that a uniform distribution is what is an uniform distribution. And from this, you need 5 numbers. So runif 5, you run, it's 0.1. You can also specify that you want to take 5 random numbers between 10 and 20. You see, they have generated 5 numbers between 10 and 20. And after running this, if you run again, you will see that the numbers will change because these are random numbers. So every iteration will change them. You see, now it has this. Now again, you run this. Something else. Again, you run. Something else. So random numbers are being generated through the uniform function. Or you can use what is called the R norm function. Norm stands for a standard normal distribution. And in R norm, you then fit in the number of observations that you, the number of random numbers that you want to generate. So 10. So because it is a standard normal distribution, the variance is 1 and mean is 0. around 10 random numbers have been generated. Now in our if you are doing a field survey, although you are, most of you are undergraduate students who do not do field survey, but it is good to know that if you are doing a field survey and you are selecting your samples from a population, then generally you need to select them by what is called simple random sampling. And if you want to then stratify or whatever you have to do comes on later. But the basic sampling method is a simple random sampling. Now, how do you do simple random sampling? You do simple random sampling by basically, suppose you are doing a survey of a village. You mark the villages, the households in the village by numbers, give them numbers, 1, 2. You just move around the village in a particular way. Let us say you start from your left-hand side and you cross the entire village, putting numbers on every household, and you come back to the same point and complete the entire village numbering. Suppose you have generated, you have 100 numbers, 1 to 100. So you have, that is the number of houses in your village, and you have generated 100 numbers in the sense that you have given one number, unique number to every house. So you have 100 numbers. The X is 1 to 100. Now from these, for your sampling, in order to carry out the survey, you need to collect, let us say, 20 households. Now the question is, how do you collect that 20? You do that by simple random sampling. The basic idea, obviously, your statistic or your statistics teacher must have told you. Basically, the probability of getting included in your list would be equal for everybody. Fine. Now, how do you do that in R? How do you select? You just write a command, sample. From where do you want to draw the sample? You want to draw the sample from X, which I have defined as 1 to 100. This is the list of your houses, numbering 1 to 100. And you want to take 20 samples, 20 households. You have to pick up randomly from the samples between 1 to 100. And you run that. So you should go to the 78 number house, 68 number house, 48 number house, 31, so on and so forth. This is a random sample. You are creating the sample, the probability of inclusion is the same. If you follow this methodology, the chances are that the sample estimate will be close to your population parameter. That is why we do simple random sampling. Now, sometimes we want to have replacement. That means that we can repeat the sample. So 20 replacement, replace equal to true. Then some values will be repeated. 95, 38, 25, you see 98 again repeated, 84, 73, 59, 51, 2, so on and so forth. So again, if you run it again, it will change. You see earlier 78, now there is 7, 68, 88. So repeated sampling and all that, I'm not going because that is not the agenda for today. So if you want to draw a sample after you have from on the basis of an R program, it is very easy to. Okay, now we need to understand how R works a bit before we go into data. Now, I had sent you to Dr. Naidu. I had sent a data file, a CSV, that is a comma separated value data file. You have to save that data file in a particular folder of your choice. Now, R, when I am working in this R, R is taking a particular directory within my computer as the working directory. Now, if you want to know which is the directory that R is working on, you write get wd, press enter. You see, it is working on C user Shobhanil documents. But my data is not stored there. My data is stored somewhere else. So I need to, all of you need to do it, because without that, it will not work. Because till now, I have been typing in the data, but now I will read the data from various methods. So you need to then set the working directory, set wd to the directory that you have saved that particular file in. So C colon slash, this will be different from for different users. You need to know the path where your this thing has been saved. Documents and all my thing are stored are saved in this R workshop. If you now say great working directory, it will show this. This is now my working directory. All the files that are there within the working directory, you can just pick them up. If they are not there in the working directory, then you need to specify the entire file of the path. C colon this that. It makes your life difficult. So it is better to come to the directory where your file is stored. And generally, when we work in R, what we do is we store the directory. For every project, every work, every kind of data analysis that we are doing, we store the data in separate directories such that R does not mix it up. So you need to do this. All of you have got that data, HDR data that I had sent. Hello.
Yes, sir. They had been mailed all the links that you had attached.
So please save the data in a directory and convert the R working directory into that directory before proceeding further. Otherwise, we will not be able to do it. In the meantime, let me clear all the data that I have created, because now we are going into how to read the data. Read data into R. Now, for reading the data into R, you first need to know what is the data that you have. So in our case, the data that I have sent you is basically a .csv file. So in order to read a .csv file, first let us assign a name, HDR, that is Human Development Report, is the name under which I want to save the data within R. That means HDR is the R object which will assign my database to. So till now we have assigned numbers to R, then we assigned vectors to R as an R object. Then we said that we can name the matrices as R objects. Now we are naming the data itself as an R object through the read function, read CSV. Why read.csv? Because our data is in CSV format. If our data is in some other format, then we will have to use some other command, which I will show you in just a minute. So what is the name of the data? You just place, you see it has already come. Because it is in the working directory, it has already come. And I run this. Here you see data has been loaded, 188 observations of 12 variables, clearly visible. Now, suppose it is not in CSV format. You can click here, import data set. Just above the data, there is this import data set. Now, you have to know what is the data format that your file is stored in. Suppose it is stored in stata format. So, from stata. Now, you have to browse where is the file. And the file is basically here. Open. So it will just store the data. That can also be done. That's in case you are loading it from Stata or Excel or other file formats, you can do it in this way. It will be easier for you. But if it is CSV, then the best thing to do is to just. So this is my HDR. Now, first thing to understand, what is HDR? So we say class of HDR. Run it. It is a data frame, data.frame. Data frame is an R object which stores data. And data in R is a collection, is like a matrix. Data frame is a collection of the variables that we have. Now, how we have stored the data here, you can see it from here. You just click it. This is a very bad way of looking at it. Suppose we want to look at the data. You say head HDR. Run it. You see, this is the data. It is showing you the first six rows. Head command shows the first six rows of the data. HDI rank, country, HDI level, HDI value, life expectancy, expected years of school, mean school years, gross national income per capita, continent region, country short, income level, region, so on and so forth. So head. So we have seen that this is the head of the data. Then we can also look at the tail of the data. How the data ends. So tail HDR run. This will give you the lowest six rows. Whatever, however the data is arranged. No sorting. It is just showing you as is what is basis. In whatever manner the data is arranged, it will show you the first six rows and the last six rows. Suppose you want to look at the first 10 rows, then write head HDR, comma 10. HDR, by the way, is not the name of the file. HDR is name of the data frame in which you have stored that file. Similarly, tail, comma 10 will show you the 10 data, 10 rows. So you have taken a look at the data, and then what should be done is, you don't know what are the variables. You know from here, but this is a visual inspection. But if you want to know what are the variables, what are the variable kinds, you need to use what is called the str or the structure function. You say HDR and then you say HDR. That is the data frame. It will give you the structure of the data frame. So these are the variables. It's a data frame of 188 observations. And this is the name of the variables. I dot 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 HDI rank int. Int stands for integer. Basically HDI rank 1, 2, up to whatever it is. Country is obviously a character. Afghanistan, Albania, Algeria, so on. HDI level, whether the countries are low or high or very high HDI. So low, high, this is a character variable and we'll come back to it very soon. HDI is the value of the Human Development Index, and you know that the value of the Human Development Index has to be between 0 and 1. So it is 0.465 and so on. Life expectancy, mean expected years of school, mean years of school, GNI per capita and so on. This gives you the structure of the data. From this data, you know that these are the variables and these are the characters of the variables. I mean, the what kind of variables they are. And you can also use the summary command. As I was saying, summary is a very handy thing. You write summary HDR. Now see what it does. For the numeric variables, it converts it into the minimum, first quartile, median, and so on. But for rank, this does not mean much. Now, country is a character variable. So therefore, it cannot do that. HDI level is a character variable. So HDI, again, it has given you the distribution. GNI per capita, it has given the distribution. Life expectancy, minimum 45, maximum 84, and so on. Now, three, four variables are important here. Now, okay, before I go there. Now you can see that this variable HDI rank is written in a very bad manner and it will create problems. So first thing that I understand from looking at the head, tail, the structure and the summary of the data is that the name of the variable is very problematic. I need to change that name. So you write column names of HDR. Run it. These are my column names. And this column name in particular has to be changed because it is not making much of a sense. So column name is a vector. And this is the first element of the vector. So column names HDR is itself a vector. And the first element of that is this. You run this. You have to change that to just HDI rank without all the this. HDI rank, and you say you can again recheck whether what you have done is correct or not, and you run this. And this is, you see, the name has changed. Earlier it was I dot dot whatever. Now it is simply HDI rank. This can be done another way. I also am not liking this name, country short. It is not meaning much. I want to change it to country code. Obviously, I can change it in this way. This is the fifth element. This is the ninth element. So this country a short should be the eighth element. But sometimes if you have a very large data set, you cannot count. So it is good if you run this point. You say, let us name HDR. HDR is the file, and I am creating another database with the same HDR such that the changes are there. The command is mutate. You can understand mutate means change. By the way, if you have to use the mutate command and all that, you have to first load tidyverse. That's why the first thing I did is to load tidyverse into my R environment. Now, mutate is followed by, let us just have a look at what mutate is. So mutate is the function. First element is data. Then you can keep it, you can remove it, whatever. First element is data. In our case, what is the data? HDR itself is the data, comma. The syntax for changing the variable name is the new name. I want to name it country code is equal to country. I want to change the name of the country short to country code. So the new name is equal to old name. And I run it. And I again run column names HDR, see what happens. No. It has just added another variable country short. Why? Oh, sorry. Yeah. My mistake. Sorry. Yeah. So it should not be mutated. It should be actually, sorry. The function should be renamed. Now let us look at rename. Rename is this. Rename is the variable through which you change the name of the rows. So HDI is the data, comma, country short is equal to country code. Run it. Sorry. Okay, now first what we need to do is we need to remove this. I have committed a mistake by introducing this country code variable in my data. So I need to remove this. So what should I do? I say HDR, comma, that means take all the rows minus 13. This is the 13th row. This number is the 13th row. It has given me the entire data. So I have to store it in HDR such that I preserve the data and do this. Now you write column names HDR. And you get this, and I have to change this country short into country code. So I again write HDR as rename HDR, comma, new name country code equal to country short. You run this, and then you look at the column names again. You see, country short is no more there, country code has been replaced. Okay, so now what can be done is we have done this. We have renamed the two of the columns we have renamed by two different methods. Now suppose you want to know, you just want to look at the fourth row of the data frame. So HDR, again, our box, brackets, fourth row and all the columns. Run that. You see HDI rank 34, country Andorra, HDI level very high. You want to look at the fourth to seventh row due to whatever reason. You want to look at the 10 13 and 16 rows. 10, 13, 16. If you have to pick up random row numbers, you can do this. 10, 13, 16. Random, and by random is an English term, not the statistically random sense. You can just look at whatever row you want to look at. Suppose you want to look at I'll come to it later. Suppose you want to look at these rows, but you want to look at the value of the let us say this life expectancy, expected years of schooling, and mean school. Only these three you want to look at. So you need to know that life expectancy is here, that is the fifth. So expected school is sixth, mean school is seventh. You write 5, 2, 7. Life expectancy, expected school, mean school. 10, 13th, and 16th. 10, 13, 16. So you can do various kinds of combinations such according to your need, which will do it. Now, another important property of data frame is that you can extract the variable itself. You can extract the entire columns by the dollar sign. The moment you place the dollar sign, you see the names of the variables have come. So let us say HDI, dollar HDI, you run it. It will give only the HDI values for all the countries. HDI, dollar, income level. You can get all this. So the data frame dollar column name will give you the entire column. Data frame dollar column name. Yeah. So now suppose you want to build another data set, HDR more, which will store the data for the countries for which the HDI value is greater than 0.5. You want to simply look at those countries for which the HDI value is greater than 0.5. How do you do that? You can do that by this, that HDR is the name of the data frame. I am creating another data frame called HDR more, the HDR data frame, such that HDI is greater than 0.5. So HDR dollar HDI greater than 0.5, all the rows which will satisfy these conditions, because you see HDI is in a column. Okay, let us look at the head, then you will be able to head of HDR. You see HDI is in a column. So when I say HDR dollar HDI greater than 0.5, so the columns is automatically truncated into only those values for which the HDI is greater than 0.5. And then you extract those rows, because you are actually operating on only one column. You do that and you then look at head of HDR underscore more. See, all HDI values are greater than 0.5. Obviously, because we have done it in that way. And here we have another data coming up, database, data frame, 159 observations and 12 variables. So this is one way of creating the frame. Now you want to know that what is the number of countries that has a value greater than 0.5. Obviously, we know it is 149, but we can also do it in this way. Count, and then we say filter. HDR, HDI greater than 0.5. What it is doing? It is filtering the HDR data frame using HDI greater than 0.5. Or in other words, it is taking only those values from the HDR data frame where HDI is greater than 0.5, and then we are counting the number of observations there. You see 159. Here also HDI mode is 159. So this is, sometimes you need to do that before you do your proper analysis. Sometimes you need to know that what are the number of observations in certain categories. For that, this is an important example. Okay, now before proceeding further with the data, we need to know about conversion of variables. Suppose I have a vector A, which is C, 0 within quotes, 1 within quotes, 5 within quotes, 6. So this is a vector. What is the type of? Type of A is obviously will be character. But I know that these are basically numbers. Somehow they have been within quotes due to typing error or whatever, because of which they have been converted into a character vector. But I need to convert that into a numeric vector. How do we do that? A as numeric A. Now you look at the type of A. And you want to know how the A looks like, 0, 1, 5, 6. So you can convert a string vector into a numeric vector provided the strings are numbers. If the strings are something else, there will be some, if the strings are actually strings, then it will show an error. Now, let us come back to our, this is a very preliminary example. I should have told it before. But let us now come back to our data frame. Let us again look at the structure of the data, structure of HDR. And you run it. You see, this is the data. Now you see, HDI level is low, high, high, very low. This is important for our analysis. This is in economics terms, in econometric terms, what is called a categorical variable. That you have a categorical variable which classifies countries, in this case, into various groups. Categorical variables can be male, female, urban, rural. These are categories, but they can be expressed in numbers. Now, if you want to use this in your analysis, you need to convert them into categorical variables. Here, it is only a character variable. A categorical variable in R is called a factor. Factor. So, what do? We convert these variables into factors. So, first variable that I convert is HDR dollar HDI level. And I say that convert this into a factor, and now you just type question mark factor to understand what the factor does. Factor X is equal to a character vector, labels equal to levels, so on and so forth. So basically, there are two important things. One is levels, the other is labels. So what it does is, let me just show you without HDI dollar HDI level. HDR dollar HDI level. Now see what it does. It does nothing. I mean, it is stored. Now you see here HDI level is a character. Now again, after this operation, we look at the HDR, structure of HDR, and you see HDI level has become a factor with four levels, high, low, medium, and this has been converted into numeric vectors, 2, 1, 1, 4. In order to understand this better, just write HDR dollar HDI level. You see low, high, high, very high, that was the thing. But now high, low, medium, very high. So high is 1, low is 2, medium is 3, and very high is 4. So low is high, 1, high is 2, very high is 3, and whatever. In this order. So it has picked up high as 1 because it appears alphabetically. H, then L, I, J, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, and V comes much later. So three levels, high, low, sorry, four levels, high, low, medium, and very high. But suppose you don't like it. You don't like this to be this, because this will create unnecessary problems in your econometric analysis later on. So how do you do that? For that, I need to reload my data. Otherwise, it will be a problem. I just reload the data and everything else. Then I say levels equal to C, and you say what your level is. We will specify the levels starting from which to which. So we want it in this level. First low should come, then medium should come, then high should come, and then very high should come. So we are specifying the levels. Okay. Now before we run, let us again look at the structure of HDR. You see, HDI level is a character, low, high, high, very low. And if you just plot HDI level, then it shows this, that the first observation is low, then high, high, then very high. And then we convert this by running the run. And then again, we look at low, medium, high, very high is now. Earlier it was what? Earlier it was high, low, medium, very high. Now I have deliberately start to take low as the base, then medium, then high, then very high. Nothing else changes. Here it is low, high, high, very high. But if you look at the structure of HDR, then you see HDI level is a factor with four levels, low, medium, and low means one. Medium means 3, 4, whatever. High means 3, and so on. Okay, now I need to do one thing. I need to convert this, the things that I have done. So I need to change the column names into HDR, and then rename this. As that, when I run the structure again, be careful that do not run the factor argument twice. If you have done it once, check it. And if you need to make the changes again, then you need to reload and make the changes. Otherwise, everything will get jumbled up. But this is not the only variable which is a categorical variable. You see, continent region is also a categorical variable. Income level is also a categorical variable. And region is also a categorical variable. So we need to change all this into categorical variable for better analysis if you want to do regression. Now, how do we do that? We do that by using what is the mutate function. Mutate HDR form. I'll just copy the codes from another program that I had written save time. So this is the thing that I have done. That continent region equal to factor continent region. I have not specified the levels. Let us just keep it at that. Income level is again a factor of income level. Levels equal to low income and so on and so forth. And you just run that. There is some problem. You see, this plus sign means there is some problem. Most probably I have You see, the moment you miss one of these, you see that this bracket is not closed. That is why it is giving a problem. This is very important. The moment you do not close a bracket or give extra brackets, R will give you an error. Now let us see whether it is fine or not. Even then it is not coming. Okay. Okay, another bracket is needed here. Now let us see. Even then it is not coming. Okay, so there is some problem which I don't know why this problem is happening. Continent region equal to factor continent region. Now it has taken. Yeah. So now you see the structure again, structure of HDR. You see, HDI level I had already converted. Now continent region is a factor with 5 levels. Income level with a factor with 2 levels, low income. Oh, doesn't matter, I will just run this read here. Then I have to run. Sorry for the inconvenience, but it sometimes happens. It is just part of your life. Don't get worried about it. So HDR, HDI level, and then I need to do this lower middle income, but there are two more levels. One is let us look at the data. Let us say unique. Unique gives the unique values of HDR dollar. This is the income level. You see, these are the unique values. Low income I have taken, low and middle income I have taken. Then I need to take high income. Remember the equal to and the small scale, small letter, capital letter, all these things are important. Comma, upper
middle income.
Sorry?
Yes, sir. Upper middle income. Yeah.
Upper middle income. Now you run this. Now everything should be fine. Structure of HDR. Yes. You see, income level, 4 levels, region, 5 levels, so on and so forth. So I have now arranged my data. There is no problem, no further problem with the arrangement of the data. Now you need to jump into the analysis. First is, suppose you want to know the what are the various countries in the various levels of FDI. FCT count, factor count. And what is the variable? HDR dollar HDI level. You want to know how many countries are there in each level of categorized according to each level of HDI. So low, there are 44 countries, medium 39, high 56, very high. And you want to know how many, what are the kind of regions, FCT count, HDR dollar region. And you run it, you will get the distribution of the regions. Africa, 53 countries, Americas, Latin and North America, 35, Asia, 48, Europe, 41, Oceania, 11. So in this way, once you know the factor variables, you can count the various categories, distribution of your data into various categories of the factor variables. How many are lower income countries, how many higher income countries, how many regions, Africa, how many countries, and so on. Once you have arranged the data into factors. That is why I was trying so hard to convert into factors. Now, summary statistics. Now we need, obviously in statistical analysis, we need to calculate the summary statistics. Obviously, we can summarize whatever variable you want to summarize. Suppose you want to summarize the GNIPC, that is gross national income per capita. Now, this is what it is. But suppose you want to know the standard deviation of GNI per capita, then SD stands for standard deviation, HDR dollar GNIPC. Run it. This is your standard deviation. Variance is HDR dollar GNIPC. This is your variance. And similarly, you can look at, suppose you want to know the correlation, or COR stands for correlation, between life expectancy, HDR dollar life expectancy, comma, HDR dollar GNI per capita. So what is the correlation between life expectancy and GNI per capita? It should be positive. Let us see. The highly positive, 0.62 is the correlation coefficient. This gives you the correlation. Now, you see, this is a bit, this is a bit tedious, because every time you have to write HDR dollar. So then we use what is called the pipe operator in R, which is denoted by this symbol, percentage greater than percentage. Let me show you with an example. HDR is my data, and then percentage on percentage, and let us then write for life expectancy or GNI. Run this. Oh, it is not taking due to some reason. But piping is very important. I will show you the piping. Okay, let us just say that we need to construct an HDI new, where, as earlier, you see, we were doing this, the HDR more HDR, HDR dollar, HDI greater than 0.5, so many times, you have to write HDR, that it might make a mistake. So what does the pipe operator do? The pipe of HDI new is equal to HDR. And then the pipe says filter HDI greater than 0.5. You run this. Another HDR new has been created. And look at the head of HDR new. So what it does is, it starts with the data frame HDR, and it passes the data frame directly into the function. So if you did not have the pipe, you had to write filter HDR, comma, HDI greater than 0.5. So on and so forth. But if there is a pipe, the pipe basically passes the direct data frame directly into the function without repeatedly writing it. When you say filter HDI greater than 0.5, it understands that HDI is coming from HDR. But without the pipe, if you simply write filter HDI greater than 0.5, it will show an error, because it does not know where is this HDI coming from. But because you have said that HDR pipe filter HDI greater than 0.5, R understands that this HDI is coming from this HDR data set. And that is how it is not showing any error. I will show you some more examples of pipe. But before that, you know about skewness and kurtosis, right? Let me show you the skewness. For skewness, you have to load another package. As I said, that as you go up the ladder, the number of packages being installed will increase. Install.packages within quotes moments. Just do this. Install.packages bracket within quotes moments. After you have installed the moments package, you have to call the library moments. And when you call the library, there is no need for any quotation marks. So library moments I have already have in my computer moments. So now just type skewness. Skewness of, let us say, HDR dollar GNIPC. You see, positive number. That means this is a positively skewed distribution. What does a positively skewed distribution mean? Anybody? It means that it should have a long right tail. In order to know that, we say HIST. HIST is the histogram, HDR dollar GNIPC. You see, the plot is coming here. Here you will have the plot. So it shows, I will show you better plots, much good looking plots tomorrow. So this shows that it, the GNIPC has a very long right tail. That is why it's a positively skewed distribution. And if you say skewness HDR dollar HDI, it's negative. The skewness is negative. So this histogram must have a long left tail. Let us see whether that happens or not. HDR dollar HDI. Is it left tail is longer? It's a negatively skewed distribution, although it's a bimodal kind of distribution. But we will go into that in tomorrow's lecture. Now, suppose you want to know the mean per capita income by various HDI level group countries. So mean per capita income by HDI level. How do you know that? Now you will see how the pipe operator operates. HDR is the data pipe. Group by. What you want to group by HDI level. Again, pipe. Summarize, not summary, summarize. Mean per capita income is equal to mean of GNIPC. See what happens. Run this. You see, it is grouping by HDI level. Low, the mean per capita income is 2268. Medium, the mean per capita income is 6906. So on and so forth. Suppose you want to also know the median. Just write median. Median PCI is equal to median GNIPC. Running. See, another column has been created, median PCI. Here the mean is greater, whatever you can understand from this. So mean and median per capita income by HDI level. So this is the group by and summarize function. It is very useful function. And it can be used to summarize large sets of data into very small tables. And through that, we come to the table function. Now, table, before we go to table, I want you to install this package, install.packages. I should have said it yesterday itself. Ulrich. WOLDRI. DRIGE. Ulrich. Ulrich is the name of the book, very famous econometrics textbook. Sorry, DRIDGE. Install.packages Ulrich is the data set of the very famous econometrics textbook by Ulrich. So please install that. After installing, you can just call, there are many data sets there. I don't have time to show you. Just we call the wage data set. Let us say we have the wage and we say Ulrich. Now this double colon sign after the name of the package is that you are not loading the library, but we are loading something from the library, wage one. So this is my wage data. Let us look at the head of wage. So this is the wage data. This is the wage. This is education, experience, tenure, non-white, female, married. I will work extensively with this data tomorrow. But let me just show you how to construct tables. First, let us convert two of these variables, female and married, even non-white, but like now for female and married, they are basically categorical variables. Female 1 means she is a female, 0 means he is a male. Married 1 means married, 0 means unmarried. So we convert them into data dot, they're not data. In this case, we have named it wage dot female, wage dollar married, wage dollar female, and wage dollar married. And you run this entire code so that it will get converted into factors. Factors are most importantly categorical variables in R. Now, once we have done that, we need to construct a table for married and sex. That means how many male are married, how many women are married. For that, we just say the command is table. Let us say we say married equal to wage dollar married, comma, sex equal to wage dollar female. Female is the sex variable here, and you run this. You see, unmarried 86 male, 120 female. Married 188 male, 132 female. So this is what is called a cross tab. Now, the moment you have a cross tab, you can check whether the two variables are related to each other or not through the chi-squared test. So let us save this in a R object called marriage sex. That means marriage and sex table, and run this. So it is stored in this R object, and we need to perform a chi-squared test. I hope you know chi-squared test. Hello.
Yeah, dear participants, you can unmute yourself and you can answer.
Do you know what a chi-squared test is? I don't think so, because undergraduate, I'm not sure. Anyway, don't mind chi-squared test. I don't have the time to go into the details. But anyway, you can construct the table in this manner. Chi-squared test basically shows whether there is a relationship between these two variables or not. It takes, because I have discussing it, let us just say. So you say chi-squared test married sex, and the chi-squared value is this. The p-value is less than 0.0001. So we say that the p-value for the chi-squared test is significant. We therefore reject the null hypothesis that there is no relationship. So if your p-value is very less, which is 2 in this case, the null hypothesis is there is no relationship. But if the p-value is very less, then we have to reject the null hypothesis and accept the alternative hypothesis that there is some relation between marriage and sex. And we can then calculate the probability and all that, which I am not going into the details. So I'm jumping the t-test also, because t-test measures the statistical significance between difference in mean. Instead, what I do is we look at sorting a data frame. Earlier we had showed you how to sort a vector. Now we are going to sort a data frame by a particular variable. Suppose we want to sort the data in the order of GNI per capita. Suppose we want to sort it by GNI per capita. So we just write HDR order HDR dollar GNI per capita. See what happens. So the variable is basically ordering the HDR GNI per capita according to the rows, and will return the entire this thing error, object of closure is not successful. I don't know what it means. Oh, sorry. This should not be the third bracket. This is be the first bracket. That is the problem. Now you do this. You say this is the new data set sorted according to GNI per capita. Now, how has they sorted it? This is GNI per capita. They have sorted it by the lowest, from the lowest to the highest. But suppose you need from the highest to the lowest, then just put the minus sign here. Run it. Now you see it is the highest. Qatar is the highest. Then the second highest, Kuwait, Liechtenstein, and so forth. So you just put a minus sign. This is, there is another way of doing it by the arrange function. So I'll just show you the arrange function. So let us say HDR pipe and arrange. Arrange descending HDSC is descend GNI per capita. See what happens. Now you see again the GNI per, okay, it is looking ugly. So let us say, let us just say that it is DF, that is a data frame. We do this and we then look at the head of DF. You see, again, Qatar is the... So you can do it in two alternative ways. Either you do the order command or you use the pipe and the arrange command, and descending or ascending, you choose. Okay, I have taken enough time. So I will just end today's lecture, and tomorrow we'll start from wherever I end. It is more than 2 hours I have been talking. So let me just stop. With just last topic is dealing with dates. Now, in some cases, you will find that date is a variable, particularly if you are doing time series analysis. You want to know that COVID infection in the world every day, then the date is obviously an important characteristic. Now, how does R read dates? In order to understand that, sorry, just type this in the console. Today, bracket, run this. Could not find today, then you say system.date and you run it. You see, 2021-0306, year, month, date. That is how R reads dates. In order to deal with date, what you need to do is install.packages within quotes lubridate, install it. After installing it, call the library lubridate, run it. I have installed my lubridate library. Now you run the today command, will give today's date. Is it 2021-0306? Now, there are three formats in which dates comes: year, month, date format, YMD. Suppose you have a date like let us say somebody is saying that the date is 2021-02-28. Year month date, it might come as a character. So in order to convert it into date, date is another kind of variable. It will be YMD, year month date. Year is first, month is second, date is last. Run this, year month date. And then you can have another thing called month, day, year. Month, day, year. Suppose you have a string which says January 31st, 2021. Now you want to convert that into date. What do? You say MDY. Sorry. MDY. And you run this. You see, 2021-01-31. And the last is, like we write in English, day, month. Suppose somebody has given you this. Somebody has given you this, that 21st, 6th, March, 2021. And you want to convert it into proper date format in Hard, then you just say DMI, date, because you know that day is coming first, month is coming then, year is coming last, and you run it. You see, it is converting it into the proper Hard readable format, 2021-03-06. I think I should stop here. So this class, I have just been able to manage the basics of Hard. So tomorrow, we will start with the analysis of how to do various kinds of things. So I stop here. If there are any questions, I am ready to
answer. Everyone, you can put them in the chat box, or you can directly ask them to sir if you have any doubts or queries. Anyone? So we should conclude.
Yeah. Dear participants, is there any questions? Please ask directly the speaker, or you can chat in the box. You can type in the box, chat box.
If there are no questions for tomorrow's class, let me just tell, write two, three packages that you must load. One is install.packages, describe data. This package needs to be loaded, describe data, LM test.
I think please share in that chat box, sir. Maybe.
Oh, yeah, sorry, yes.
I think. Welcome back, Dr. Manoj Pandey, sir.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, maybe.
I just want to say hello to Dr. Chaudhary. We could not interact in the morning session.
Hello, yeah. Sorry, I could not attend the morning session because I had to take care of some household responsibilities. This is the weekend, this is the only time we have.
I understand that. But yeah, I just attended I think last half an hour, so it was great.
Thank you.
Yeah, and it also gives me some guide, some direction for tomorrow's class, so I can go through some of the things that you went through today.
Yes, sir. I think these are the packages. I think in graduate level, we don't know. I think master degree level, I think.
So shall we conclude or?
Just a minute. actually in this pandemic situation, maybe you have to accept all these things, even in administration, some principal, some other, and maybe other speakers. Actually, there are 200 participants are registered, but yeah, around 80 participants are there. Dear participants, if there are any queries, let you know. Please text in the chat box, or you can ask directly. Yeah, I think there is no questions and Q&A, sir, and there is no, maybe this is the fundamental, maybe people are comfortable. And really very happy in both sessions, sir. I particularly thanks to Dr. Manoj Kumar Pandey and Dr. Subhinil Chaudhary, sir, who took up our time to give us a valuable session. And particularly in graduate level, and even research scholar, maybe some are in faculty members also there, you know, most of the some other different universities and scholars. Definitely it is helpful to all. Thank you very much for your input, sir. Yeah, thank you. And please proceed to RC. I think hopefully we'll see you tomorrow at 9:50. We start at 10 o'clock, the first session, followed by Dr. Manoj Kumar Pandey. And second session will be same, the time is 1:15. I hope you people are getting good outputs and outcomes in this session. Yeah. And Harshit, please conclude that.
Yes. So on the behalf of whole FIC team, I would like to thank Dr. Manoj Pandey and Dr. Subhanil Chaudhary for your valuable time, and also Dr. Appala Naidu, our convener, for being there throughout, and all the participants for your utmost sincerity and patience and cooperation. So I think we should conclude, and we'll resume for the day two of the session tomorrow at the same time. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Manoj sir and Subhanil sir. So will you...
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Neha Pandeji, also, because he's the assistant of Neha Pandeji.
She is there. Thank
you, ma'am. Yeah. Other colleagues.
Thank you. Thank you.
We'll see you tomorrow at 9:30.
See you. See you,
ma'am. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you. All the participants can leave the meeting now.
Yeah, dear members, so we'll see you tomorrow at 9:50 on the FIC. Dear participant, please leave the meeting. We will see you tomorrow, the same time, 9:50. We'll start the same session. Thank you, one and all, for all your participation and patience. Thank you all.